Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
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 Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Sarasvati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesa Sunyavadi Pastyakya Devi Satarine Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasudevi Gauravati Vinda
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the 7th canto, 5th chapter, Prahlad Maharaj, responding to his father's taunts and harassments, mentions the 9 processes of devotional service, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Archanam, Padasevanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atman, Nivedanam, 9 processes of devotional service. And bhakti, it consists of execution of devotional service according to the, what we say, directions of the Shastras, and the directions of the spiritual teachers, especially the founder Acharya, His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. So in that explanation, there are ways to execute devotional service, and they're divided into 9 different categories. And the basis of all the processes, as mentioned by Srila Prabhupada, is to hear about Krishna, to hear what to chant about Krishna, to hear and chant so we can remember about Krishna, to offer wonderful prayers to Krishna according to the Shastra directions on how to offer prayers, and also offering individual prayers which are in line with our desire to serve the Lord and to purify our hearts of material desires, to worship the Lord according to the Pancharatriki Vidhi system, the Archana Vigraha, to worship the Lord in this form as a deity. And Srila Prabhupada also gave us that process in a very, what we say, detailed way. And serving the lotus feet of the Lord, as done by Lakshmi Devi in her service to Lord Narayan. And one of the processes that consists of that is visiting holy places, honoring serving Vaishnavas is also serving the lotus feet. And honoring special holy days like Janmashtami and Gaurapurnima, like that, Ram Navami. These are all categories that fit in serving the lotus feet of the Lord. Becoming a friend to the Lord, carrying out the Lord's instructions, that's in the mood of Hanuman, just serving and doing whatever is required according to the directions of the spiritual teachers. And becoming a friend of the Lord. And ultimately, to surrender one's life completely in service to the Lord, as was done by Bali Maharaj. So these 9 processes are the complete foundation or the way to execute devotional service. And both in the Chaitanya Bhagavat and also in Srimad Bhagavatam, there is an indication that must be followed carefully, that one must execute the Yuga Dharma along with the other 8 processes of devotional service. And the Yuga Dharma is to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Mahajano Yena Kata Sapadda. This verse from the Mahabharata mentions that the truth of religious principles are hidden in the hearts of the self-realized souls. So they teach the process of devotional service. And according to Srila Prabhupada, that In order to make progress in devotional service, one may execute any of the 9 processes, but each of them must be accompanied by the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, which is the Yuga Dharma in this age. I had an interesting experience in my own travels. I was going to Germany at one point, and I had was called in by the temple president of one temple in Germany, and he had some concern. And the concern was that he had a very, what we say, dedicated pujari, who was always on time and very nicely worshiping the deity and decorating the deity very nicely and even did extra service. But this particular devotee didn't chant. And the rationalization from this devotee was that there are 9 processes and this is the one that I'm absorbed in, so according to Shastra, I'm following Shastra. Therefore, it's not necessary to follow all of them. I want to follow this one, and I'm attached to serving the deities. And so he asked my opinion. And so I answered. I said, well, according to Prabhupada's statements, that one must chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, which accompanies all of the other processes of devotional service. And I said, I feel that this person will not be able to last in their service. They may be very, what we say, exemplary and very enthusiastic now, but as time goes on, unless they chant and consider the chanting as a principle of their whatever else they do, their service will go down. And it wasn't long after that that I got a letter from that temple president and said, you know, I tried, but the person wouldn't change. So I let them continue, and then eventually they gradually stopped their service. Because one cannot, what we say, circumvent the instructions of the spiritual master and expect to get the results, especially when one is directly instructed by authorities in that regard. So one must chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. When we hear about Krishna, we chant about Krishna, we remember about Krishna. We worship Krishna in different ways, and all these processes are mentioned in the Shastras and exemplified by certain personalities. For instance, hearing was done by Maharaj Parikshit, which he listened to the Srimad Bhagavatam recited by Sukadeva Goswami without breaking for 7 full days. They didn't even consider his bodily needs, such as eating or drinking or sleeping. He simply was absorbed in hearing the glories of the Lord, so much so that when it was completed, he was completely fully self-realized and was ready to take his destiny, which was to die by being bitten by some strange creature called a snake bird, which actually happened, but he wasn't at all, what we say, in any kind of material consciousness. He was absorbed in, after hearing the glories of the Lord, he had become fully self-realized, simply by the process of hearing. Sukadeva Goswami is glorified as being one who is glorified for chanting, because he chanted for 7 consecutive days the glories of the Lord. Prahlad Maharaj, although he was being tortured in so many ways by his demoniac father, he never deviated his consciousness away from the lotus feet of the Lord, and therefore he was always protected from whatever dangers he was put in. So much so that his father was completely mortified and couldn't understand how is it possible. But this Shastras explained that when one is absorbed in thinking about the Lord or chanting the glories of the Lord, then the material energy cannot touch that person. And listening to Prabhupada yesterday, Prabhupada was saying, if one is always chanting Hare Krishna, there's no question of Maya ever touching that person. Of course, that is an elevated process to be able to constantly chant the holy names of the Lord. But through practice and through purification of the heart, as we perform our devotional service, we become more and more attached to chanting, and then chanting becomes more and more a feature of our day-to-day life, not only the 16 rounds, but we can remember Krishna at any time simply by chanting his holy name. And I did a little research. I thought, this is an interesting statement by Prabhupada. How many times did he say, chant 24 hours a day? And I decided, let me just do a little research of some of the statements. And I found so many statements. Just in ordinary lectures, or apparently ordinary lectures with Prabhupada, was just speaking casually about the process. He would say, and yes, you know, the process is you worship Krishna, take prasadam and chant Hare Krishna at 24 hours a day. So he wanted to emphasize the importance of always remembering Krishna as the feature of success in our devotional practice. And then, of course, offering prayers to the Lord. The Shastras mentioned there are different ways, the different types of prayers we can offer. And it's recommended that we recite prayers by the great souls like that. But one can also recite individual prayers that are in the mood of devotion, such as, you know, how to overcome difficulties in our devotional life, how to execute my devotional service in such a way that Krishna will be pleased, how to free myself from certain attachments and certain, what we say, difficulties that come by way of association. And so these are authorized. One should not ask for material things. That is not part of any form of prayer. Sometimes certain religious practices teach that by executing spiritual process and by following very carefully, you receive material benedictions. And sometimes the practitioners ask for material benedictions, thinking that even these material things will be ways to so I can increase my service to the Lord. But that's a very precarious, it's not very in line with the idea of surrender. It's more like asking for something in order to, you know, Krishna's giving everything anyway. If we simply look around, we'll see whatever we need in life is already available. And when we execute devotional service to Krishna, we actually see Krishna's mercy coming in different ways. No need to ask for anything material. That's not a prayer. That's not a real prayer. And then, of course, worshiping the Lord in Archivigraha form. Sometimes we say that, we think mistakenly that only those who practice, you know, a pujari service or on the altar, they're actually doing the archanam. But actually, archanam also carries out into temple etiquette, how to behave before the deities. This is mentioned in the Nectar of Devotion. Ways to relate to the Lord while one is in the temple room or in the presence of the Murti, like that. This is also part of the archanam process. And carrying out instructions, and we mentioned serving the lotus feet of the Lord, going to holy places, serving Vaishnavas. Vaishnav Sevas is actually serving the lotus feet of the Lord. And of course, developing friendship with the Lord and surrendering everything, it's mentioned that these two parts of the nine processes, or these two processes, are on more on a spontaneous platform. They come more on the Raganuga platform. So one can practice that and follow in the footsteps of a particular personality who's executing devotional service in that way. And therefore one can develop that mood of service. In other words, it's called serving those who are on the spontaneous platform by hearing about them, chanting their glories, and praying to them for guidance in our own devotional service. So we can do that in order to help us come to the platform of spontaneous devotional service. And the last one, of course, is surrendering everything to the Lord. The process of surrendering everything to the Lord means whatever I have belongs to God. And therefore, my time, my energy, my resources, my intelligence. Bali Maharaj was the example. He was the king of the world, but he surrendered everything to the lotus feet of the Lord and became glorious as one of the Mahajans, although he was a demon. He was a demon, but because he had got the association of the Lord and got the opportunity to surrender everything, he took advantage of that and became not only free from his demoniac propensities, but he was able to get the opportunity to have his own planet where the Lord was the doorkeeper. That's nicely described in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam in the story of Vamanadeva. So these are the 9 processes of devotional service. Now, I'd also like to speak on Srila Rupa Goswami's verse from the Upadeshamrita, the 6 loving exchanges between Vaishnavas. This is a very important principle. What are the 6 loving exchanges between devotees? One is to speak one's confidential thoughts, and the other one is to hear another's confidential thoughts. Another one is to give gifts, and second is to receive gifts. And the last one is to give prasadam and to receive prasadam. So these are the 6 loving exchanges. And Srila Prabhupada writes something interesting. It's quite a powerful statement. He mentions in the purport of that verse that we have established this ISKCON society in order to facilitate these 6 loving exchanges between devotees. So that's the purpose of these temples. The purpose of the temples is not simply only to come and see the deities. The purpose of the temples are educational institutions where we learn about the process of devotional service and at the same time associate with other devotees. Association with other devotees is based on these 6 loving exchanges. It can be extended to a broader definition, such as speaking confidential thoughts. One may speak about the glories of the Lord, and one may hear the glories of the Lord. That is a loving exchange between devotees. Giving gifts, we do that. We give gifts to Krishna. Actually, in India, the culture is that when you go to a temple, you should always bring a gift for the deity. A piece of fruit, a donation, something. When you come to see the Lord, you always offer something, some gift like that. That's the culture. So doing that amongst devotees kind of makes a nicer relationship between the devotees giving gifts. This is the Christmas season, right? And the stores are full of junk, anyway. Which they call, presents for your friends, It has become so commercialized and so, overshadowed with economic interest that the actual spirit has been drowned out. But the spirit is really wonderful, to give gifts to each other. And in spiritual circles, that bonds a relationship between 2 devotees. To give a gift, sometimes just like we know birthdays are like another way of saying, welcome to the material world. When you have your birthday, right, your karma cashes in and here you got a body, right? So from the spiritual point of view, to take birth is not very good. But still, we honor others by saying, happy birthday, right? We say we welcome and we honor a person on the day of their birth. So we use that as an opportunity to give gifts. So, and what does that do? That endears the gift giver to the person and vice versa. So giving gifts is a very important part of devotional life. For instance, I remember someone gave me a picture that I really liked. It was a very wonderful picture of Lord Nrisimhadev in Sridhar Mayapur. And I had never seen this particular picture, and it was very mystical, extremely mystical picture. And so I thanked the devotee, and I kept the picture. And then I remember after a while, I couldn't find the picture. So I was looking all over for it, and looking, trying to find that picture, and I couldn't find it. So I gave up looking. And then I think a couple years later, I just happened to take a book from my shelf, and I opened it up, and there was the picture in the book. And what that did, immediately when I saw the picture, I was happy to see it, but I thought of the devotee who gave me the picture. So immediately there was that thought of that devotee, and bringing back that experience of someone giving you a gift and receiving a gift, and you just start thinking, you know, in nice thoughts towards that devotee. So giving gifts, everyone does that, and so we should do that in a regular way. Can I put you on the spot? Nobody's raising their hand. Do you like to get put on the spot? How many of you like to get put on the spot? Raise your hand. How many don't like to get put on the spot? How many of you don't like to raise your hand? How many of you don't like to raise your hand when you're asked why you don't want to raise your hand? So, anyway, I'll put you on the spot. So tomorrow, give a gift to somebody, one devotee. It could be anything. It could be, you know, prasadam, a picture. What else could you give?
I don't.
Huh?
Chocolates.
Muffins?
Chocolate.
No chocolate. I will not go into the reasons why. No chocolate. You can give a flower. Or a glass of water. Something. It's nice. Give a gift to the devotee tomorrow. And so giving gifts, actually, Prabhupada, throughout his books, understands that this Krishna consciousness movement is like developing a spiritual family. And it's not like a bunch of strangers come together and we just look at each other like, who are you? And then we go home, you know? We should make friends with the devotees. Just come up and say, my name is this. What's your name? And actually develop some friendship. Even if it's simple and very ordinary, to get to know each other, and then we get to appreciate each other, and then when we worship together, it becomes more like a family mood. Like that. So that's there. And Prabhupada said, we're like a family. And there are, Krishna is our father, and the spiritual master is like the uncle. And we're all like brothers and sisters. That's the idea, really. Because to go back home, back to Godhead, means to actually be in a mood of peace with every living entity. One should have no ill feelings towards anyone. And that's the qualification for going back to Godhead. So in opening up one's heart, we start to appreciate others, and we also start to appreciate ourselves more. So giving gifts is a way to do that. I think even the materialists, they even make games of giving gifts just to get to know each other, like give a gift to somebody and just to find out who got your gift, you know. They put a whole bunch of gifts and then some game they play, and then you get a gift and it's from somebody you don't even know. And then all of a sudden, you get to know the person after a while, after you get the gift. So giving gifts is like part of Krishna consciousness. And the last one is giving prasadam and accepting prasadam. Now this is interesting because prasadam is actually Krishna. So when you're giving prasadam, you're giving someone Krishna. And when you're accepting prasadam, you're accepting Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada was asked, Prabhupada, some devotees like to eat prasadam and some devotees like to serve prasadam. Which is better? Prabhupada said, they're both the same. Because one is giving prasadam, one is receiving prasadam. So the medium is Krishna, which is Krishna in the form of transcendental foodstuffs. So that's one of this one very nice, wonderful devotee in Denver, Colorado, Mother Nidra. She's a senior Prabhupada devotee. She, wherever she goes, she carries books and Mahaprasadam. And whoever she meets, she'll give them either Mahaprasadam or a book, something. No matter who it is, she'll just make friends with everybody. And here, here's some nice food from God, something. And so that's one way, carrying Mahaprasadam with you, giving it. Like that. And Prabhupada would always have Mahaprasadam in his rooms wherever he was. When devotees would come, he would distribute prasadam to devotees like that. And he also said that no one should come into our temple without getting prasadam. It's the duty of the temple to make sure that all guests at least get something, even if it's only one sweet ball. They should always get prasadam. Prabhupada would ask if someone, when someone was leaving, did they get prasadam? He would always ask, did they get prasadam? Make sure they get prasadam. So that's one of the loving exchanges between Vaishnavas, is to give prasadam and to receive prasadam. And sometimes we also say revealing one's mind to another. That can be understood in different ways, but revealing one's mind is not about telling everybody your problems. Because you're dumping your garbage on them. It's about explaining, you know, what you're experiencing in devotional life. And maybe you get a clarification on how to practice devotional service better. And sometimes it could be problem solving, where you might have some difficulty, some situation you need some advice, and you find someone who you can trust, someone who's qualified to answer your questions or your inquiries, and that's a loving exchange like that. So these are the things that make up Krishna consciousness, and we have to practice that. It's not a matter of just letting it happen. It won't happen unless we practice it. We actually have to practice that. And as we do that, we'll find that as we get to know each other in devotional service, our relationship with Krishna becomes more natural. It becomes more natural. Some devotees are shy, and that's nice, but you can always do something. You can always do something. Some devotees are very shy, or some are more extroverted, some are more introverted, and some are inverted, trying to get out of their version. Well, we have to come out of your shell. There's other people around. Really? It's nice to get to know devotees like that. Bring, as Bhagavad Krishna says in his 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the one is friendly to others is very dear to me. He mentions that in the last. So a devotee by nature is friendly to everyone. He makes no enemies. He has no friends, but he's friendly to everyone. What it means he has no friends, it means that Krishna is the friend of everyone. And we be friendly with others, and we may also have closer relationships with certain devotees. But ultimately, the devotee is always the well-wisher of everyone. If someone asks you, can you do something for me? You say, thank you very much. The devotee is always happy to serve. We're always happy. Sometimes we get served and sometimes we get to, we serve, but we're more happy to serve. It's more happy, it's more fun, to put it in a very simple way, to serve than to be served. Because that's our nature, to want to serve. So these sex-loving exchanges are natural and are foundation for developing our relationship with Krishna and our relationship with Vaishnavas. Because everything is based on sarusanga, 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 sarva sastri hoy, lavamatta sarusanga, sarva siddhi hoy. And that just by association we can become Krishna consciousness. So, these are the six ways to exchange. Talk about Krishna, hear about Krishna, talk about philosophy, hear about philosophy, give gifts, receive gifts, make plans to give gifts, give prasadam, accept prasadam. And as we do this more and more, then we find that our temples are no longer just a bunch of people coming together for worship, but actually it's like a family atmosphere. Then we don't want to go outside and look for relationships in the material world, because everyone needs relationships. We have our friends and our families, and sometimes that's more obligation than actual friendship. But on the spiritual platform, when we make friends with devotees, the foundation is based on our relationship with Krishna, which is the only basis of any relationship, because Krishna is there in everything. We create these temporary relationships in this material world with our friends and our family members and our society in order to facilitate the needs of the body. But that disappears after some time and even changes while we're still in this body. That's temporary and may usually is fraught with a lot of difficulties. But when we make friendships with devotees, we're actually practicing Krishna consciousness. So these are ways to facilitate that friendship by giving gifts and talking confidentially and exchanging prasadam like that. Okay, and the last thing was the five rasas, right? Shantra, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, Madhurya. Okay, that's that topic. There's the five rasas. So the basic principle of all the rasas is Dasya, to serve. We can make friendships with Krishna, become Krishna's parent, become Krishna's child, and have loving relationships on a paramour level with Krishna. But these things develop through the process of dasya, service to the Lord. So in the beginning, we simply execute our devotional service under the guidance of the spiritual master. And as we make progress, we start to learn what is our relationship with Krishna in the spiritual world, based on these different rasa. Rasa has no English equivalent in terms of definition. The best possible word is mellow. Mellow. If you were to translate the word rasa, it means mellow. Mellow means sweet mood. What is the sweet mood of my relationship with Krishna? That's the word mellow, more or less. That's the closest we can get to a definition. But it really means the internal nature of my relationship with Krishna, based on devotional service, like that. So, and dasya is there, and one can come to the platform of serving Krishna as a cowherd boy, as a parent, and as a lover. But these things develop in the higher stages of bhakti as we practice the mood of dasya, to serve. The more we serve, the more Krishna reveals to us our nature in the spiritual world. But that's on the higher platform. But we can read about the cowherd boys and how they're serving Krishna and playing with Krishna, having wonderful games with Krishna. We can read about Krishna's parents and how they take care of Krishna. We can read about the gopis' love for Krishna. And we can aspire to follow in the footsteps of these great souls by praying to them and hearing about their pastimes, and also trying to not imitate, because if you imitate, that's pretense, and it also is offensive. But one should simply glorify those who are serving in a certain way that as we're attracted to. We may be attracted to Krishna, to serve Krishna in different ways. But one should follow the process given by the acharyas and work under the guidance of the spiritual masters in executing our devotional service like that. But in a more specific way, it's up to the temple leaders and the spiritual masters to engage the devotees according to how best they can make advancement in devotional service. This is really important to understand. That's the responsibility to make sure that a person is not only engaged in devotional service, but they're engaged in such a way that they're making progress in their devotional service. Sometimes a person is engaged in such a way that is not according to their nature, and because they're not able to follow a different type of nature, they may also find this devotional service difficult. You know, a person may have been very learned in philosophy, and that's very nice, but if you don't give them a chance to express that and to develop that, then after a while, they will feel unhappy in their process of devotional service. So, it's up to the spiritual master and the temple leaders to very carefully observe those that are working under them and see how best they can make advancement. Filling in the needs of the temple is secondary. Engaging the devotees according to how they can make progress is primary. So we have to balance those two things in such a way that they don't conflict with each other. They can complement each other. But at the same time, the most important thing is how a devotee can make progress like that. To be engaged according to how best they can make progress. Okay, any questions? So I covered all three topics. I tried to. In a very, concise way. So any comments, questions on six loving exchanges, the five rasas, the nine processes of devotional service? Yes, Bhakti Vik.
What about inquiring submissively from a spiritual master? Isn't that also part of
it? Is it? That's also what?
Part of the six processes of service.
Inquiring submissively? Well, that's a principle of all the processes of devotional service. Nothing specifically. Tad vidhi pratipatena paripasyena sevaya upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninam tattva darshanam. Krishna says in Gita that one should inquire submissively with a desire to render service. So without submission inquiry, one cannot be, what we say, get the mercy of the spiritual master. So, yeah, that's for all the processes. That's not for one's particular type. That's the foundation of devotion. How can I serve? How can I make advancement? Yes. Such an honor.
As you mentioned that we need to be careful not to imitate Radhatmika Bhaktas. So what in higher level, so what should be the practical way we should do? Should we just glorify them?
Yeah, you glorify them, you hear about them, you try to understand their mood of devotional service, you read about their pastimes like that. If that's recommended. That's called anuskaran. There's anuskaran and anushiran. Anuskaran means to imitate, anushiran means to follow. So our problem is following in the footsteps, but not imitating. If you imitate, that's pretense, and it's probably a way to actually destroy your devotional service. Sometimes people want to imitate devotees on a higher platform, but they're not on the higher platform, and therefore it's all external. So one should practice devotional service and learn the nine processes, the nine stages of devotional service. I think we'll talk about this next week. What stage of bhakti am I on? There are nine platforms. There is adau strata, sadhu sangha, bhajana kriya, anartha nivritti, nishta ruchya shakti, bhava, and prema. Nine stages. So when we come in, we have come preliminary faith, and then sadhu sangha, that's association with devotees. When we associate with devotees, we develop a taste for devotional service. And then when we develop a taste, one becomes serious and wants to take initiation or find shelter with a bona fide spiritual master. That's the third process. That's called bhajana kriya. And then through the guidance of a spiritual master, one starts to free themselves from unwanted material desires. And that's the stage of anartha nivritti. So we have to know what level we're practicing devotional service. So we know how to practice and how to go to the next stage like that. So that's mentioned in the shastras like that. So most of us, you know, we're aspiring to understand more and how to become what we say fixed in our own devotional service. But eventually one has to come to the point of taking shelter of Krishna's representative. Taking shelter of Krishna means taking shelter of Krishna's representative. You can't take shelter of Krishna without taking shelter of Krishna's representative. Because Krishna gives us the process that taking shelter of me means to take shelter of those who are representing me. Taking shelter is not initiation, but taking shelter is preliminary to initiation, where one works under the guidance of Krishna's representative. Execute the process accordingly, but takes what we say relevant instructions and guidance from a particular spiritual master like that. That's necessary. And that's one of the processes. And then from that, we get rid of those things that are blocking our spiritual path. That's important. It's not always about doing, it's about not doing. Not doing what you shouldn't do and doing what you should do. In Sanskrit, that's called anukula and pratikula, or anukulasya, pratikulasya. Things that are favorable, things that are unfavorable. So, if we're doing things that are favorable, that's recommended. But if we're doing things that are unfavorable at the same time, by doing favorable things, we will find it very difficult to make it spiritual advancement. Example is, an elephant takes his bath very nicely and then goes and throws dirt over him the next moment. So there's things we have to avoid, such as illicit sex, intoxication, meat eating and gambling. These are fundamental to the process of purification. We cannot purify our heart unless we get rid of these, what we say, sinful activities. These are not just material desires, they're sinful activities. So, like that. So that's the process. The process is very, what we say, simple, but at the same time, it's very complicated. Do this, but don't do this. So, knowing what not to do, or getting rid of those things that are bad habits, or what we say, things that are obstacles in our devotional life. So these are some of the... So following in the footsteps, you can't imitate. Imitate is pretense. But Prabhupada says, when you're ready to come to the platform of understanding your internal mood, then the spiritual master will come and show you. Anything else? Any other questions? Okay. Honestly,
I feel like gift exchanges is lacking in the Christian communities. How can we encourage devotees to give gifts to each other?
I did. I said, I'll put you on the spot. Tomorrow everybody has to give a gift.
Is it okay, like, you know, Marge, how you mentioned people doing the little games of, it's called like Secret Santa, devotees do something like that to get to know each other and... like,
whatever it takes. Well, you know, we can't get too much into the something that is not too spiritual. One of the ways to really bind with each other is to worship together. When you chant together, when you pray together, when you worship together, when you take prasadam together, when you do spiritual activities together, that's the best and most recommended way. And these other things, that the six loving exchanges can be, done within that context. But if we just do these giving gifts, but we don't chant together and don't worship together and don't discuss, it really won't develop very much. Practice, that's all. And it's not like you have to be friendly with everybody. You shouldn't have any ill feelings towards anyone. That's natural. But you should always have certain persons you can talk to and share Krishna consciousness with. And not just your wife or husband, but someone else outside of that. That's there too. Yeah. So I think there's an old saying, just do it. Just do it. Yes.
You mentioned that just giving gifts is not enough. It has to be...
That's part of it.
Well, the first part is we in the temple, residence, we have this Secret Santa thing going on before Christmas. We have all the boys put their names in a hat, so we say, take out folks and names. That's just roots in the residence.
It's nice.
The flip side of that is you were saying how it has to be that augments worshiping, serving together.
That's the main thing. Yeah, that's the main thing.
That's, I find, to be difficult to inspire both myself and others to worship, serve.
What do you think is the problem, or what do you think causes the difficulty?
Primarily me, because I find myself struggling with my own side of attending to my program, and not being able to, inspire enough with the desire of the other devotees in order to do the same, because I'm dealing with.
Well, you live outside, right?
No, I live in the temple.
You live in the temple?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I make it to the morning programs. I'm physically there.
Well, that's good. But that's what I mean. You have to be physically there.
But then I don't have the time to... As a Gurukul teacher, it was very easy to inspire, of course, to do my children. But it was very easy because my service was to inspire kids, teenagers, to get involved in their devotional life. Very easy. No problem with that. But because my service in the temple is different from being an ashram teacher, it requires some of the skills of an ashram teacher, but because I'm saddled with administration, I don't have the time or the inclination to do the necessary part, like you mentioned, inspiring others and devotees. So I find myself, so that's primarily it's a problem, my inability.
Sounds like a managerial problem.
Yeah, that's
pretty. Yeah, you need a second manager. Somebody who can assist you in doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Then you can do more and do those things that you say you can't do. Yeah, it's always a feature of struggle to see how to balance our sadhana with our material, with our service, and being in a position of leadership, how to inspire others. Therefore, I think a management system that facilitates these things is conducive to getting the job done. So you have to see who can take on more responsibility. And for the devotees in general, Prabhupada said, you make advancement in spiritual life by how much you take on responsibility. So it's not like you have to take more than you can handle. You should always think, what else can I do? Like that. If the temple president is overburdened, then you should, I should think, well, let me help so I can, he can do his service better. Yeah. It's a team. They say, it's like everything goes down to the lowest common denominator. When you're in a group and somebody's really weak, either you pick up that person and make them strong, or that weak person will pull you down. So it's always, being in the group is that the stronger one should be very much inclined to giving encouragement and opportunities for those who are weaker to move forward, like that. Then we function as a whole. When you live in a temple, you're more like one group. If you're all living in the temple and there's a bunch of individuals, what's the use? What's the use? I got my program, you got your program. If you're living in a temple, it's like we're all trying to serve Sri Sri Radha Vallabha together. So what I do will affect you, and what you do will affect me, and what you don't do will affect me. What I do and don't do, what I'm supposed to do, will also affect you. So it's really a tight ship when you're in the temple. So therefore, as a leader, we have to inspire people to come up to a higher standard, and at the same time be an inspiration for, and be fixed in our own service. So from the practical level, you might have to see where some of the administration things you can distribute to others in terms of the services. Because, you know, people see you not only as a temple, but as a temple president, but as a spiritual leader, in the sense that you could give that. And so if you're not able to give it because you're imbalanced, you're doing these other things, then the devotee should think, well, let me see what I can do to take some of that burden away. Yes.
You were here in the 70s when Prabhupada was here. How was cooperation among the devotees like in the 70s compared to cooperation among the devotees now?
I can't really answer that question completely, but I can give you a theoretical response. Our movement's grown. Before it was a temple-based movement, 99.9% of the persons in the movement when Prabhupada here was living in the temples. We had practically no congregation. Now it's the other way. We have a few people living in the temple, and about 85, I think Jayapataka Maharaj said 95% of our devotees are living outside, congregational members like that. So the whole dynamic has shifted. And because it was such a temple-based movement, there was a lot of cooperation and enthusiasm, because everyone was so closely connected to each other in the service. Now we're not so much. And there's other reasons also. So the whole format of how the society is structured now has changed. It's changed. But we shouldn't lose that enthusiasm that comes by way of, temple, right? The temples should not lose their enthusiasm. They should keep that strong enthusiasm. And when Prabhupada was personally present, because he was such a powerful spiritual force, that wherever he went, you know, everybody centered around Prabhupada. But now, what we need to do now is bring Prabhupada back. And that's what my seminar is next weekend. So please come, How to Bring Prabhupada Back, which will create that, what we say, stronger mood again amongst devotees. Prabhupada has somewhat drifted into the history of our movement. And he's not so much in the forefront as he was before. But that doesn't mean, because he's physically not present, that his personal presence is still not here. It's still here, but it's accessed in a different way. So keeping Prabhupada in the center means keeping that spirit of cooperation that was there in the early days strong. Yes?
I'd like to be a billionaire so that devotees that are working 60, 70 hours a week, we could pay them so that they could move near the temple and share more time with the temple rather than with worldly companies. So, what do you think of that?
I haven't thought about that one. And I don't know if I want to. Devotional service. Service with devotion, not with payment. In some cases we do that because either they get paid and do something for the temple, or they go out and work for their own interests. But that's a compromise. Ultimately, we should be so inspired as to be able to inspire people to surrender in devotional service and have enough devotee power to cover all of these. Not that we have to, bring somebody over from another country just to get a Philip Bajari position. Or he gets a green card and 2 years later he's gone. He's working in a gas station pumping gas. So he can make enough money to bring back to his grandmother and, get in a, where is it, in Konark or something, someplace in India. It's not like that. We don't want that. We want to be able to preach Krishna consciousness, inspire people to surrender. And that surrendering is not hard. If we're inspired, we're surrendered, we'll inspire others to do the same. It's up to us in our own spiritual life to inspire others to do the same thing. Any other questions? Do you have a question?
I have a sort of strange question.
I've been hit with many strange ones. Why do you shave your head? Because it's cool, man.
My question is Lord Jesus Christ and his woman, does he have his own planet?
Prabhupada said that. Somewhere between the spiritual and material worlds, he said. Okay. You want to go there? Easy journey to other planets? You can go wherever you want to go. You just focus on serving and worshiping in that mood. You can attain any planet. But that's not our program. The Prabhupada said, Jesus Christ, because he said, there's so much more that I can teach you, but you're not ready. He wasn't speaking high philosophical teachings. He was speaking simple devotion to people who are basically very sinful. And so if they follow Christ, they can go to the planet of Christ. Is Somebody's got a call. It's okay. So, and you can ultimately, he will take his followers by teaching them pure devotional service. When they go to their planet, then he teaches pure devotional service there. Prabhupada said, Christ was a pure devotee speaking mixed devotion. Because he couldn't speak pure devotional service. People were not able to hear that. Even today, we're not even able to hear it. So we kind of like package it in different ways. So. So he has his planet in between the spiritual and material worlds. Yes? Anasuya, you had a question?
Maharaj, how do you inspire the whole community to be this community?
How do you inspire?
A weak community.
A weak community? There's many ways you can inspire. One of them, just by having programs and asking people to come and participate, like having kirtan programs. When we chant together, that's inspirational. You can also have what we call Jai Shishi Gornitai Ki Jai, Shishi Raha Gopi Bhavade Ki Jai, Jaina Bhavade Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai. Another thing you can do is just have a work party. Say, okay, everyone comes this Saturday and we got a whole bunch of services to do. We're going to fix the walls, we're going to paint this, we're going to scrub the temple. Here's the brooms, here's the mops. And when you're done, the best pizza maker in the temple and the community is going to make pizza for everybody. Wow! And then, you do that. You just have a big program and you just clean the whole temple, paint the places that haven't been painted in 200 years. Move out some of the stuff that's been there 400 years. And, just clean the whole temple and fix it up and just do a whole, program. It's like Gundicha Marjanam. And then at the end, big feast. Sounds good?
Sounds great.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, devotees like to do that. Just come together, just take one Saturday and just go for it. And then the temple president can just make a whole list of all things that need to be done. Clean the kitchen, throw out some of those shoes that have been here since the first shoes were made. Whose shoes are these? Well, I don't know. They've been here for the last 30 years. he died 20 years ago. So, we just let things kind of like pile up sometimes. So you paint the walls, that need to be painted, clean the corners that nobody ever went into. It's a big place. Just do the whole maha cleanup, repair, restructure, refinish. And then after you do it 1 week, you'll think, let's do it again next Saturday. That's the way to get devotees together, just like a big service program. And then you have to have a big pizza party. Not only pizza, you can have ice cream too. Really. This is what makes devotees happy, just serving together and having nice prasadam at the end. That's Krishna conscious. It's not ordinary. That's one way. Anything else? Other ways to bring devotees together, have kirtan programs, have seminar programs. You need to do some different things, like just churn the ideas of what can we do as a group. We can have, you can do study groups, they're already doing that. We can have more of them. I mean, here you have the Prabhupada Festival. That's really nice, bringing devotees together. That's a wonderful program. And other things. If I sat here for a while, I could probably think of a few more things. But, you know, you could always think of something to bring devotees together. Serve together, chant together, take prasadam together. In the summertime, you can go on picnics or what else. Go on yatras together. I know in some temples, the senior devotees organize a yatra and invite as many people. This year, we went on a boat. Yeah, and Bhakti Charu Maharaj decided to have a boat festival in London. And so for nine days, we were on the ocean. 250 devotees came from the Bhaktivedanta Manor congregation. And Radhanath Maharaj came, and Bhakti Purushottam Maharaj, and Sachinandana Maharaj came. Who else? Bhakti Charu Maharaj, Yarubar Prabhu, Malati. And we just were under the ocean. And we stopped in different places and had Harinam. In France, in Spain, in Amsterdam. And we just went from port to port doing Harinam. 250 devotees, 300 devotees doing Harinam. Like that. So it was good. Devotees loved it. It was fun. Everybody got together. So we do these different things just to kind of like, you know, bring devotees together in different ways. You know. It's one idea. Okay, anything else? Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
A quick announcement. Tomorrow, Friday night, we're having Friday night kirtan. Maharaj will be here along with Narendra Maharaj as well. Friday night kirtan, the program starts at 7 with Sunday Arctic, of course. And we'll have kirtan until we drop. So the rest of the evening. So that's tomorrow, Friday night. In the Saturday morning, it's our second Saturday of the month. We will have a Saturday morning program. Candramauli Swami will be here for that. Narendra Maharaj will be speaking, and will be here as well. Candramauli Swami will be giving the Srimad Bhagavatam class Saturday morning. So you're here for that. We'll have breakfast for you thereafter. So Friday night kirtan tomorrow, and Saturday morning program as well.
Everyone should think, what service can I do? Don't let the devotees do all the service and you just come. Come and do some service. Wash some pots. Clean some bathrooms. Get involved.
You have to thank the lobby.
It's fun. And the thing is, you're doing it for Krishna. It's devotional service. And Krishna really appreciates any service. Make this your temple. It's not our temple. It's your temple. Where the people who are here are like caretakers. They just take care of it, but they're inviting everyone to take part in the temple. That's all. So come in and participate. Right? You can do different things. Serve out prasadam. You can also, devotees can cut vegetables, right? In the kitchen, like that. Not many things, right? So, anybody has some skills, like if you're an accountant, you can do some accounting work for the temple. If you're a doctor, can you offer your services to the devotees when they get sick? You can give some free service. Or if you're a lawyer, you may also give some legal advice when respondent needed. Anything, whatever your skill is, just think. I can use it to serve Krishna. I can use it to serve the devotees.